abounding in faithful love, forgiving of sins. But I want to draw your attention to this right here. There's a comma at the end of that. God doesn't finish the statement with just that. He goes on, and this next part is exactly what his disciples were thinking about when they asked the question. Continuing in verse 7, it says this: "But who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation?" Now, this is where it gets uncomfortable. We see that God is willing to forgive sin, but we also know that God is a God of justice, and that there's a price that has to be paid for sin. And God is serious about punishing and giving consequences to sin, even to the third and fourth generation. We see this concept clearly illustrated throughout the Bible, and it's not comfortable, but it's there, and it's part of who God is. We see it clearly illustrated with King David. King David is described as being a man after God's own heart, yet he was a sinful man. He was an adulterer, he was a murderer, he was a liar, and he was a perjurer. And those are just the things that he did while he was involved with Bathsheba. If you look in 2 Samuel chapter 12, starting in verse 9, we're going to look at the consequences that David faced for those sins and draw out some ideas here. Starting in verse 9, it says this: "You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and have taken his wife to be your wife and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house. Because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife, thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor. And he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son, for you did it in secret, but I will do these things before all Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said to David, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, because you did these deeds and have utterly scorned the Lord, the child who is born to you shall die." Here are the key things that I want you to get from this. First and foremost, if you look at the end, David's sins were forgiven. He was in a right relationship with God. However, there were penalties that overflowed from his sin into the lives of other people. It would affect his family. It would cause strife within the kingdom. His wives would pay a price, and his child would pay a price because of what he did. We can see this clearly illustrated today. We know this is true. We don't like to talk about it, but we know it's true. When a family is divorced, it's not just those two that are affected. It ripples out into the children, friends, community. When there's someone who's in a position of trust with a child and violates that trust, it doesn't just affect that child for the rest of their life. It ripples out into the entire community. We can look at things like September 11th and see that our nation is carrying scars and baggage because of the act of a few sinful men. My point is this: our sin can affect others. That's one of the reasons that bad things happen to people. And you can turn this statement around, and it means that others' sin can overflow into your life, those consequences. So the question is, how do we deal with others' sin overflowing into our life? How do we cope with that? And my easiest way to give you a place to go with this is to give you an illustration of something horrible. On April 15th, 2013, was the 117th annual Boston Marathon. There were a couple evil men that decided to put two bombs at the finish line. Three people were killed, 264 were injured, 14 people required extreme amputations. I don't want to focus on the negative, though. I want to share with you one positive story that came out of that. This is a story that a woman posted to Facebook. She had been running in the race. She didn't make it to the finish line. Right before she got there, the bombs went off and she was diverted down a side road. And she realized that her husband and her kids were waiting for her at the finish line. So she's frantically trying to get through on her cell phone, and everybody was doing the exact same thing, trying to find out if their loved ones were okay. She eventually gets through, finds out that her husband and her kids are okay. And she just sits down right where she's at, and she breaks down, just overwhelmed by the situation. There was a couple walking by that saw her. The man had been running in the race, and he had one of those little space blankets. And they stop, and he puts the blanket around the woman, and he starts asking her, "Are you okay? Is your family okay?" Once those important questions are asked, he asks her, "Did you finish the race?" And she can just shake her head no. She's just so overwhelmed. And he does something then. He takes this medal off of his own neck because he had finished the race, and he hangs it around her neck, and he says, "You have finished in my book." She posted this message on Facebook along with the story. "Odds are I will never see this couple again, but I am reaching out with the slim chance that I will be able to express to them just what this gesture meant to me. I was so in need of a familiar face at this point in time. This couple reassured me that even though such a terrible thing had happened, everything was going to be okay. This couple became the hands and feet of Jesus in response to a tragedy." I don't know if they even honor God as being God, but God used them to pour good into this woman's life. Romans 12, 21 says, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." God is bigger than any sin that can affect our life. God can use tragedy, and God can use sin to bring about good. When we face tragedy, we have an opportunity to become that good that outweighs the evil. When you look at things like the Boston Marathon and other things, the number of people doing good far outnumbers those doing evil. And I think that that's because God overwhelms the evil with good. People who don't even call him Lord and Master. I want to return to John chapter 9, though, with the blind man. Because Jesus gives a reason why the man was blind, and it wasn't at all what the disciples thought it was. Verse 3, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him." The reason that this man was born blind wasn't because of sin. It was to reveal God's power. God is bigger than anything in this world. He can overcome anything. God is the be-all, end-all, the alpha, the omega. This man was born blind so that through his weakness, God's power could be shown. And each and every one of us has weakness, imperfections, and flaws. And those are simply opportunities for God's power to be shown. The purpose of all creation is to declare the character of God. That means that our purpose within this world is to bring honor and glory to him. And we may experience difficult times to achieve that purpose, because that's when God's strength will be shown. You can't talk about bad things happening to people without talking about Job. Go over to Job chapter 1. We're going to pick up in verse 6. Here's what it says about Job and why the things happened to him. "One day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, 'From where have you come?' Satan answered the Lord and said, 'From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down.' And the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns from evil?' Then Satan answered the Lord and said, 'Does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the works of his hand, and the possessions and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand to all that he has, and he will curse you to your face.' And the Lord said to Satan, 'Behold, all that he has is in your hands. Only against him do not stretch out your hand.' Satan went out from the presence of the Lord." Job is described as blameless, upright, God-fearing, turning from evil, that there is no one like him in the land. And yet God allows Satan to come in and start messing with his life. And the answer to that is tied up in the conversation that God and Satan have. Satan tells God that Job isn't who you think he is. Job only likes you for what you do for him. If you take away those blessings and that protection, Job will curse you to your face. God allows Satan the opportunity to prove him wrong. Everything that Job goes through is written so that God can be vindicated. It's to show that God can be taken at his word. And this isn't the most comforting reason, but it is an important one. We have zero ability to hold God accountable. We need to know that when God says something, that can be taken at face value. We need to know that when God says that we can have forgiveness and relationship with him, that those are things that we can take to the bank. We need to know that we can build our lives on the foundation of God and what he says, so that whatever storms roll through our life, we are secure because of that foundation. I think that there's another answer here that we can talk about why Job went through what he did. If we look at Job through the eyes of James chapter 1, I think we can get a little bit better understanding of why he experienced what he did. Starting in verse 2, it says, "Now that you join my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, you know that the testimony of faith produces steadfastness, and let the steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." Job's faith was perfected by the trials that he went through. It wasn't about being physically perfect, it was about being spiritually perfect, lacking nothing spiritually. If Job didn't go through what he did, he wouldn't have been perfected. And it's the same thing for us. If we want our faith to grow deeper, we are going to have to meet God through trials. Now, this isn't very comforting, because when we face trials, we want to be comforted. The problem is God isn't interested in our comfort. God's interested in our healing. And healing is not a painless process. It's going to take work, and it's going to be painful. And that's what the trials in our life are. The comfort and the hope comes from, just like any person going through physical recovery, is the end goal. The comfort is knowing that we can be out of this world and the influence of any sin to be in the very presence of God. That's where the comfort comes from when going through trials. I want to return to this idea of spiritual vision. We've looked at four different reasons why God allows bad things to happen in people's lives. And you can probably find more if you start looking. But what I want to look at now is how the people affected by trials respond to those trials. If you go back to the blind man in John chapter 9, after he's healed, he kind of loses everything. When his sight is restored, the synagogue leaders throw him out. His parents are put in a position where they have to defend what he's saying, and they basically roll over and say, he's an adult, he stands on his own. That means that he loses every good thing that he had, and this is his response to that. John chapter 9 and verse 35. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped him. This man gained his sight, but he lost everything else. His response when face to face with Jesus experiencing that was to worship. When he saw clearly who Jesus was, the only logical response to tragedy in his life was to worship God. If you go back to Exodus 34, Moses, when he hears about God punishing to the third and fourth generation, his response is this: Moses bowed to the ground at once and worshiped. Moses was standing in the presence of God, seeing with clear spiritual vision the character of just who God was. And his response was to bow in worship to God. King David, after the judgment is pronounced and he knows his child is going to die, when his child finally does die, this is David's response in 2 Samuel chapter 12, starting in verse 19. Is the child dead? That's King David asking. They said, he is dead. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his clothes, and he went into the house of the Lord and worshiped. David suffered probably the greatest loss any of us can imagine, losing a child. And his response was to worship God. It wasn't to bemoan his loss and to say, woe is me, God, why have you done this to me? His response with clear spiritual vision was to say, God, you are worthy of worship. Finally, Job chapter 1, verse 20. He loses his wealth, his property, his children, eventually his health, his relationship with his wife and his friends. And when Job suffers loss, his response, I think, is very, very revealing and important. At this, Job got up, tore his robe, and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship. He said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall depart. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. May the name of the Lord be praised.
Amen.
Job recognized how good God had been to him. He also recognized that God had the ability and the right to take those things away as well. And that can be a really tough pill to swallow. But Job, seeing with clear spiritual vision, his response was to worship. This is a big concept, and I want to tell you one more story to try and wrap our head around this. When I was in the AIM program in Texas, we had a gentleman who was going to come speak to us by the name of Mike Tenero. He was a preacher in Paducah, Kentucky at the time. Right before he was scheduled to come and speak to us, his wife died. And we didn't think he was going to show up, but he did. And he said one thing that has stuck with me, this is probably 15, 20 years later, that I think ties perfectly with the concept that Job is putting out, and it helped me to understand it better, and I hope it helps you. He said this when talking about the loss of his wife. He said, I knew how good God had been to me because of how much it hurt. He recognized just how good God had been to him by how much it hurt. Great pain was a sign of a great gift from God. He saw from a place of pain, with clear spiritual vision, that God is worthy of worship. I want to leave you with one last scripture, John chapter 9, verse 5. Before Jesus heals the blind man, after saying why he was blind, he says this: I am the light of the world. The time is coming when there will be no light, is what he goes on to say. He says that the light will be gone and there won't be an opportunity for anybody to work. If we want to have clear spiritual vision, to be able to understand why tragedy happens in our life or disaster in this world, we have to have the light to be able to see that. We have to have Jesus in our life to be able to clearly see and understand. At the beginning of this, I told you a story about Mike May. But what I didn't tell you is after 43 years of being totally blind, he underwent a surgery and regained partial sight. He was able to see the outline of your face, just not the specific details. He could track motion. 2 weeks after he had this surgery, he finds himself on a flight, and he does his normal thing. He just busies himself doing his work, and about 30 minutes into the flight, he realizes, I can see. And he immediately turns and looks out the window. And he sees these white wispy things out there. And he's like, I have no idea what that is. So he turns to the woman next to him and he says, excuse me, I've been blind completely for the last 43 years. I just got my sight back 2 weeks ago. Can you tell me what I'm looking at out the window? And the woman's response is to just sit there in stunned silence. She has no idea how to respond. Is this guy serious? Is he joking? After a minute, Mike says to her, are those white things that I'm seeing, is that the tops of mountains? And she says, no, you're seeing vapor. You're seeing clouds out there, just little pieces of them. And this woman and her husband proceed to give him a play-by-play of everything that he's seeing out the window. He sees these big green blotches that are fields. He sees these brown things. He sees the ocean for the first time. And he sees these little dots on the oceans that he think is sailboats. Mike was so excited about seeing, but he had no idea what he was looking at. Sometimes we have lived in spiritual blindness so long that we have no idea what we're looking at when the light comes back. And we need somebody to explain what we're seeing. If we want spiritual vision, to know how to respond when tragedy comes, to be able to live a full life with God, we have to have that light in our life, and we have to understand what we're seeing. And God has given us the opportunity for those things through his word and through the church. He has blessed brothers and sisters here with understanding about what the scriptures are about. And I don't know where you're at. If this is your first time hearing about the light, and you say, I want that light in my life because I want to know how to respond and to live a full life spiritually with God. Or maybe you've been walking in the light for a time and you just don't understand what you're looking at. Whatever your need is, there's brothers and sisters here who would love to sit down with you and show you that light and explain to you what you're seeing. We're going to have an invitation song here in just a minute. If you have a need, whatever it is, there will be brothers down here that would love to talk with you. There will also be some elders in the back if you want to go back there and speak with them. Whatever your need is, come as we stand and as we sing.